In the words, supposedly, of Albert Einstein, if you want your children to be intelligent, read them fairy tales. If you want them to be more intelligent, read them more fairy tales. My name is Sayantani DasGupta. I am a pediatrician. I am a professor of something called narrative medicine. And now I am also a children's fantasy author. So I am essentially a storyteller and a story receiver by profession. In fact, when I was in pediatric practice, I would, on a weekly, if not daily basis, write prescriptions for reading. I had a prescription pad specifically for this purpose, and on it I would write, read to your child for 20 minutes a day. And with that prescription, I would hand the family of the child or the baby who had come to see me an age and language appropriate book to take home with them. And the reason that I did this was the same reason that pediatricians and family practitioners continue this practice throughout the country. It's that I knew that stories are good medicine. Reading together as a family is an act of bonding. It is an act that increases attachment. Being read to as a young person, it increases receptive language, the ability to understand language. Also, productive language, the ability to speak. And it could actually increase, as Einstein suggests, intelligence. There have been some studies correlating it with school performance. But to me, one of the most important things that sharing books as a young family does is it builds a potential lifetime of love of books, of love of words. But these changes, as important as they are solely on an individual or a family level. And what I'm here to suggest to all of you is something a little bit more radical. What I'm here to suggest to all of you is that children's fiction can, in fact, change the world. Now, I know that sounds like an outlandish claim, but hang in there with me. What I have come to realize as a writer of children's fantasies is this. Children's books are in the really important and really hard work of building imaginations. Not just any old imagination, but radical imagination. Think about it. It's in children's and YA fiction that mice can speak and also wield swords, that little girls can befriend big red dogs, that wizards fly around on broomsticks while simultaneously vanquishing evil, and where a group of plucky young teenagers armed solely with wit and grit and a belief in themselves and each other can potentially overthrow an unjust government. So children's and YA fiction, in a sense, are our blueprints to the future. They are our roadmaps to tomorrow. For it's inside of these stories that children not only figure out who they want to be, but they figure out what sorts of worlds they want to live in. And they get the practice in figuring out how they want those worlds to manifest. And now, if there's ever been a time in history that we are in desperate need of this kind of radical imaginative act, I'd suggest it's right now. Because if we are to deal with the religious bigotry and violence, the racial injustice, the environmental catastrophes that threaten to rent our very world apart, we are going to need not just our present-day adults, but our future adults, our future leaders and politicians and teachers and parents and artists to be equipped with radical imagination and also, I'd suggest, a sense of radical empathy, if not radical love, towards those who are like ourselves, but importantly, to those who are not like ourselves. And I think that children's and YA fiction has a really important role in this work. So, of course, diversity and representation is a critical part of this conversation. You've heard that expression, you can't be what you can't see. Well, we're not going to be able to deal with these potentially catastrophic problems if we don't have all of our children and young people able to see themselves into the future, not just surviving, but thriving and powerful enough to make change. So stories in which children of all racial backgrounds and ethnic backgrounds are superheroes saving the world, stories in which children of all family backgrounds are centered, stories in which children of all genders and sexualities and economic backgrounds can see themselves as the protagonists. These stories do the critical work of making sure that all of our young people are equipped with radical imagination. Being deprived of such stories, being deprived of positive representation, therefore, is not just unfair or unjust. It is on an individual and, I'm going to say, on a community level, deeply unhealthy. Narrative erasure is a kind of psychic violence. And I know about this violence, not just because I'm a pediatrician and a professor and a children's author. I know about this violence because I myself was an immigrant daughter who did not get to see brown-skinned girls like me being superheroes, saving the world, being protagonists, even being centered in any sort of way. And the message that that gave me back when I was young was a pretty violent one. It was, well, gee, if people like me can't be protagonists, can't be superheroes, can't save the world, then maybe I don't deserve to do any of those things. Maybe somebody like me can't even be the protagonist of their own life. And it took me years to get over this feeling of kind of battered self-confidence and bruised self-esteem. It took me years to stop wishing that my brown-skinned body or my brown-skinned family could somehow just disappear. And it wasn't until I would go on these long, extended summer vacations to India, and my grandmother would gather all us cousins around, and she would tell us these traditional Bengali folk tales, that I would finally find some sense of psychic representational healing. Because here, suddenly, finally, were brown-skinned kids like me, out there having adventures, saving the world, riding on winged horses, defeating evil serpent kings, fighting these drooling, rhyming, carnivorous rock-cush demons who were the monsters that we cousins loved to hate. And I drank up those stories like a desert traveler who doesn't even realize how parched they are until they reach the oasis. That is how desperate I was for that balm of representation. And so many years later, when I had my own beautiful, brown-skinned, book-loving children who are somewhere out there today, I decided to reach back to those stories of my grandmother's, and I decided to write my own children's fantasy series. And what I did is I took the Bengali folk tales and I mixed them with string theory, because why not? And obviously, and also because string theory seemed an apt metaphor for the kind of multi-universal experience, right? Living in multiple universes experience of being an immigrant. And then I also threw in some New Jersey humor and sass, because let's get real, everything is better with New Jersey humor and sass, am I right? And so I decided to write this series about a 12-year-old Indian immigrant daughter from New Jersey who is out there being awesome, saving the multiverse, because I wanted my kids, and I wanted all of our kids, to know that they are worthy enough to be the protagonist of their own story. They are important enough to take up room and cultural space. They are powerful enough to save the world. In the words of writer and activist Walida Imarisha, folks being empowered to write themselves into the story is what it's all about. Challenging the idea that only certain people can write the narrative of the future is also challenging the idea that only certain people can build the future. who can imagine themselves into the future? Who can imagine themselves not just surviving, but thriving? Regardless of genre, these are the questions of all of children's literature. For the future is born in these stories, in the imaginations of our young readers. Before they can make it be, they've got to have the tools and the room to dream it. Children's literature, when radically representational of our today's, pave roads to better tomorrows for us all. For it is in these spaces that young people will imagine worlds of fantastical beauty. It is in these stories that young readers will liberate their imaginations and save us all. Thank you.